¿Qué ondas, primos and primas and primes? Welcome to My Primos Podcast. This week, without Freddy, our fearless leader is out recovering, but returning from the abyss. Founder of My Primos Podcast, co-founder. Where have you been, Walter?
You know, just making moves in the background, you know. It turns out that My Primos Podcast has a very generous paternal leave program.
Oh, yeah, we do.
You know, they pay like...
You are getting equal payment right now for the last few months to take care of your kids. You've been getting paid this entire time, right?
Yep.
The exact
are
same
you sure number. We're living in the U.S. Are you
well sure? When we say equal payment we don't pay any of us, so yeah. He is getting paid the exact same amount, and that other voice you hear is our special guest, Professor Frederick Aldama, Professor LatinX himself, master of branding, because literally you could just type in Professor LatinX on Google and you get nothing but him. That is really good.
So not even Professor X, right? Like you the surpass.
A step above. Yeah, writer, educator, and supporter of BIPOC creators. Professor, tell people about what you do.
Oh my God! Well, first of all, it's really good to be back on the show. It's been way too long, but I know that the primos have lots of. You've got a deep, long list, and it's a big honor. So to be back here with you both in an equal pay situation. And what have we been doing? We've been, you know, the Latinx Pop Lab at UT is, off and running, and we're rocking it over there. We have Comics Jeopardy Mondays, you know, with undergraduate students come in and we just like, you know, for 25 points, name the concept for displaying a narrative voice in a comic book. Caption, okay, you get it, et cetera, right?
So ooh, Pop Lab's going. I got a trivia one for you. What's a Grolix?
Oh, okay, you're coming on the show. You gotta come on the Jeopardy show. What is a Grolix, Kevin?
A Grolix is whenever you see a character that's cussing, but they don't actually cuss, and you just get a bunch of little squiggly lines, that's a Grolix. So that's one of my favorite comics-only words, is that it's like...
Man, you are so in the deep in the weeds, but I knew that about you.
Yeah, it was from the guy that draws Beetle Bailey. He made that one up. Very cool. So what else is Latinx Pop Lab doing?
So, okay, well, one big thing for the calendars, Chikame and Kevin, we got... BIPOC Pop Comics,
yes.
Animation Video Game Art Symposium and Expo, March 7 through 9, 2024, right around the corner. So I want to have as many of you can come. Yeah, we got LASA students. We love LASA students. Bring them all, bring more. You have the smart, seriously, Kevin, you are making and being made by the smartest kids on the planet.
For those who don't know, I teach high school at the at a magnet school here at the public magnet school here in Austin. And the LASA students got invited to speak at the last BIPOC Pop, and that was a lot of fun. And they kept talking about that. They had a blast with it. BIPOC Pop, which I love, is it's kind of like a Comic-Con combined with an academic symposium. So it's like a half hoity-toity, you know, education stuff and half buy my stickers, which I love that combination. In fact, Chikume, we were just talking, you have little Chikumes going around there, and they are all up for those stickers, right? What stuff do you get those kids?
What's that again?
So what kind of stickers do you look for? What kind of comics and stuff do you look for as like a parent?
Well, I honestly, whatever. The more colorful they are, the more they like them. That's like, that's kind of, anytime we go to one of the cons or anything like that, they love all of it, the color, the, you know, outrageousness of it. And
Chikume, remind me and I'll bring some of these for
you. Oh, there you go.
Is that a Charlie Chupacabra?
That's awesome.
It is. Yeah, it's our Carlito.
Yeah.
He's our vegetarian Chupacabra. That's why he doesn't have any fangs.
He'll end up in the cup holder watch of the car seats.
Yeah.
Be there protecting the kids every drive.
Yeah. You should make a cups for kids
next on the list.
Yeah.
So just to tell you, Chupacabra Charlie was at the Cannes French film festival. Right, Kevin? I think you saw that. The animation film that I made.
I got to see it last year.
He actually made a little appearance there. Was one of the films selected to screen at the Cannes, and my co-producer the team that helped me, one of them actually went out to France to see it screened. It was pretty cool. I couldn't go. I didn't have time. But anyway, really cool stuff.
I could have gone in your place. You could have just told them I was you. I mean, they're European. They don't know the difference.
I told them that my cousin, my primo, and his name is Benjamin Bratt, / Kevin Garcia.
Could be.
And they've got a spot for you next year.
So Chupacabra Charlie was a cartoon, and you've also done children's books and other kinds of books as well. Mm-hmm. But the main reason we're really excited to have you on right now is because you have a brand new comic book coming out next month, right? This is part of Chispa Comics. We've had David Bowles, we've had Hector, and we have many other creators here, but we haven't really talked with you about Chispa. Mm. So mm-hmm. Could you really quick remind us, what is Chispa Comics and who are you making for Chispa?
Okay, so Chispa Comics, as some of our listeners, viewers may know well already, given that you're helming this awesome podcast or helping helm, is the kind of brain kid of David and Hector, David Bowles, Hector Rodriguez. Mm-hmm. And really it was for, there's a ton of us out here, including you, Kevin, and many, many others, creatives that want our comics out in comic book stores. Like, we love that we have our community and we've been able to build through Kickstarters and get our stuff into hands and grow readers. But there's nothing like seeing your comic in a comic book store, right? Mm-hmm. And so Chispa, working with, so them creating Chispa and then working with Scout Comics to do that, but then David and Hector coming up with in real terms, the kind of brain kid of of David and Hector, the 13.
Yeah.
And you yourself, I want to hear a little bit about yours, which is actually the 13, right?
I'm the 13th of the 13. You are the second of the 13. I'm the very last one. Well, what are the ideas of the 13 as characters? Is that these are Latino, Latina, Latine characters that are superheroes. And recently for Hispanic Heritage Month on TikTok, I was doing videos about like obscure Latino and Latina characters at Marvel. And so many of them were not created by Latino creators, and it shows, because there'll be some embarrassing stereotypes or some stuff that really doesn't age well. And the idea of us making our own superheroes, that was really appealing. That's why when David reached out to me and you and a bunch of other people, it was like, this is really cool. Each of the 13 are heroes who are inspired by, somewhat named after, and certainly empowered by one of the day signs in the Aztec calendar. So that's why there's 13 of them. But yours specifically, the first one, by the way, just came out. Sopilote just came out as we were recording this. It came out. This is Hector's. And I was describing it. Hector's first character is El Pesojero. He's been doing for over 10 years, who is basically like the original version of Superman, the one who could leap tall buildings and was strong, but not throwing planets around. And like the original Superman, he fights for social justice. But his character fights for justice on the border. And now he's introduced this new character, Sopilote, who is basically that, but Batman fighting for it in Latin America.
Mm-hmm. I can't wait. I have not had a chance to get over to Austin Comics and Books, but first thing in the morning, I'll be there.
Well, this book just came out, and I'm still going through it. I'm enjoying what we got so far. This is kicking off the adventures, but yours is going to come up right after this. 13 Origins, Sopilote number one, but yours is going to be 13 Origins, Pyroclast number one.
Mm-hmm. You got it.
What is Pyroclast?
Yeah, Pyroclast. Oh man,
you're like, I've been working on it so long. How do I get into it?
No, but I don't know if for you, Kevin, Chukame, I don't know if this is interesting or for our audience, but when David was like, okay, basically Pyroclast, that's your superhero name. Aztec, you know, we have our Aztec calendar, and this is a basic, like, 3 or 4 word kind of description about it. Go. And that was awesome. I love that, because for me, you know, Pedro, Pete Lumeris, like the others, turns 18 and really comes into this. Yeah, so awesome. Love it. Comes into, you know, this realization, kind of retrospective realization of why he's been kind of half suffering and not fully understanding himself. And by that, I mean a lot of struggle, a lot of issues. His mama is gone, right? She's not in the picture anymore. And I'm not going to, you know, give anything more away on that score. His papa's gone. His surrogate papa is basically his tío George. And he's got a little sister. And one way or another, he starts to, this kind of struggle and anger that he's bottling up starts to materialize, express itself in this hardening of his skin. And there's a moment when, in this particular story, when it actually creates this, basically this kind of outpouring, the burning up, this heating up of hot lava. And so to go back to my point, we were given a mission, but we weren't constrained too much. We were given a conceit, we were given a name, and we were given a couple of identifiers. And I loved creating this character, and I hope our readers will as well. You know, he's super cool. He's like me, Irish, Mexican, mixed. He's in a community, working class community in California that I call San Sebastian, named after the Catholic saint that has become a patron saint of LGBTQ, especially gay, Latinx folk, for the sacrifices, right, that San Sebastian made. But he's a cool kid who's like a super confident, cool guy, but kind of, you know, a loner. He listens to Nine Inch Nails, reads Fantastic Four, right? Jane's Addiction, Smashing Pumpkins, all the stuff I love, right?
Good taste.
Part of his life. Yeah. Oh, cool.
Name dropping.
And, yeah.
Hey, all that stuff is cool now. Well, it's made it
came back. Yeah, that I oh man. Okay, I'm so glad to hear that.
You know what's funny to me is, like, I teach teenagers every day, right? And it's like, when I was in high school, I would listen to some 70s stuff, but like most of the teenagers around me had no idea what those songs were. But for the kids now, everything from like 1979 to today is still fresh for them. I think largely because of the accessibility of the internet. So many of them, like, well, I was playing some music the other day and they were like, is this The Clash? I love The Clash. And I'm like, okay, all right.
Yeah, there's, you know, it is interesting. Today I gave a mock lecture for our Welcome Center admissions. We bring in high schoolers, seniors from all over Texas for a day on campus, which is actually, one of my favorite things that I do on campus for the university, because I get to be around all these really smart, awesome, mostly Latino kids from across Texas. And you're right. They know more about the 90s and like 2000s in terms of music, TV, everything than I think I do.
Yep. Awesome. Seriously, I had a kid tell me the other day, wait, you watched Friends? And I said, yeah, I watched it when it first came out. And then they go, oh, did you also watch MASH when it first came out? And I was like, how old do you think I am? All right. Well,
and they both sucked.
Well, I think Friends doesn't age well, you know. But anyway, back to the topic of Pyroclast. Yeah. One of the things that got me from your description right now is that for a lot of superheroes, their powers are kind of symbolic of their past or their struggles or their personality. And it sounds like for Pyroclast, this holds up, right? It's mm-hmm. it's part of who he is. Mm-hmm. This idea of putting this wall up and a burning one as well, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely, completely. The other cool thing, and Chico, maybe I don't know if you've got a Triumph in your garage that you're rebuilding, but that's Pete loves to do that. He's been working on, you know, he goes to the parts and pool, and he works on his motorbike. And
Pete being Pyroclast himself.
Exactly. Pete being Pyroclast himself. But going back to the 13 and yours and so on, the other thing that I love about this is teenagers. You know, there's nothing more exciting for me, besides having a teenager, than that time in our lives. Now, for better or worse, it was a time that was filled with all sorts of anxiety, surveillance, all sorts of things. But at the same time, a real time of possibility. And I think that's what the 13 for me, it's not only resuscitating and making vital our indigenous ancestral roots within a comic book superhero universe, it's also this time of development in our lives.
Yeah, because every member of the 13 is 18 years old.
Okay.
Yeah, and who are you working with as an artist on this, Professor?
Oh, yeah, so...
Guillermo?
You know, yeah, Guillermo is on this one, but Guillermo, I'm glad you brought that up. Mm-hmm. Really great to work with. And, but again, you know, you know, Kevin, it is really important. I know you've done comics in different kinds of situations, but for me, it's really important to be able to jump on a Zoom call or a phone call with the artist and kind of work some stuff out, because it's not obvious. And especially if you've been drawing like, Guillermo and most, you know, comic book, especially superhero comic book artists for mainstream comics. So, you know, the bone structure, the palette, the phenotype, all of that stuff is so ingrained in much of what they do that we kind of have to remind them that, hey, it's okay to have a wider nose. It's okay to have a browner face. You know, it's we're all sorts of different shapes and sizes. We're not all like... with like ripped abs and what have you, right?
That is actually a discussion I've had with artists before, where they would just kind of want to present everybody as this kind of vanilla white. Then I'd be like, hey, that's not representative. You know, you need to, there's people out there. Mm-hmm. But so you've been working with Guillermo Villarreal. I think I've seen some of the preview art through our little Chispa chat, and it looks really good. I'm really excited about that. Can't wait till that comes out next month. Are there any other, 13 members that you're looking forward to?
Well, yours.
I mean, okay, I wasn't fishing for that. I was just kind of curious.
I want to hear about yours.
All right, you are the second of the 13. As we said earlier, I'm the 13th of the 13. I'm working with artist Martha Ortiz, who goes by Pastel de Soriana on Instagram and TikTok and everything. Just like you, I got a list of characters with a very brief description. And it essentially came down to, you know, let's be blunt, Latina Squirrel Girl. You know, this is a character that is upbeat and positive and believes the best in people. And immediately I asked David, you know, David Bowles, can I have one of the main villains? Because there's one here that's basically an animalistic serial killer. And I want to put a really happy person against that. And that was my goal there. And I also wanted to have a Latina artist. That was very important for me. So I reached out to Martha in Mexico, and she has this like anime style that's very much inspired by, you know, cartoons and, you know, a lot of things that teenagers really like and look up to, but she also has a very dark edge to her style. So you see, if you look at her Instagram, you're gonna see a lot of characters that are like just covered in shadow, and you can see they've got terror or anger in their eyes, and it's just, it works really well. So I'm really enjoying the process of working with her. Like you said, Zoom calls are helpful. A lot of back and forth. It's been a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. So important.
So do you guys pick the style or the, like the artist has to kind of adapt himself to or herself to the art? Type of art, or how do you guys approach that?
Yeah, Professor, did you seek out the artist, or did you you know, have a plan for like a style of art.
From what you described, they kind of gave you a pretty blank slate, right? In terms of what you're working on, and then you kind of added to it. So then, you know, how much do they, how much of a leash pretty much did they give you, you know?
Yeah, I mean, Chickamay, that's a really good question. And also in that, while a given artist might have a certain kind of comfort within a style, I mean, you know, the artists we're working with and artists generally, I mean, you could pretty much be like, look, actually, I'm not thinking superhero here in terms of like conventional style. I'm thinking manga. I'm thinking steampunk, whatever. And they'll be like, yeah, you know what? It's not something I've done in a while, but I guarantee you they'll figure out, like, one, they've done it and they can resuscitate it. And two, if they haven't done it, they're willing to give it a shot. So that said, Guillermo was kind of appointed to me, but it's not always the way we work. Like Kevin just shared
I did seek out. My goal was to find somebody who had a style that matched the character, because as a reader, I might like hyper realistic. For a character like Coneja, who's going to be the 13th character, I needed somebody who could do light and somebody who could do fun.
Yeah. So,
for me, it would be interesting to, as these characters come out, you know, from 1 to 13, and they eventually you see crossovers, right? And it's like a different artists trying to cross over, and then you kind of get, you know, just to kind of
you get an
artist that seems more like, I don't know what's his name, with a particular style, crossing over with another, and they're kind of coming out, crossing over each other's path, because they're in the same universe and everything, right? So it'd be interesting to see that pop up and the paths cross. So I was
that would be cool. And in fact, we see that a lot. And I know Kevin probably has one heck of a huge long list of comics that he can talk about on this. But yeah, where you have invited artists into the story world that was created by a buddy, a friend, a fellow artist, and they go in and do the story. And it's interesting because you realize just how much the style does shape the story when you have a same story or the same character drawn by someone else, and you're like, wow, it does make a difference.
And you know what?
Yeah, it's like every other app out there that you can slap a filter on it and it completely changes the mood of a
that's an interesting comparison. I like that.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert, that is the plan. After my issue comes out, the 13th of the 13, the plan is to have a team-up book where they're all going to be in one story, and that's going to be written by Terry Blas, who is, you know, I want to say a rising star. He's done a lot of good stuff already in the comic book industry, but like he's getting more and more noticed every time. And so we're really looking forward to that. I don't know who the artist is going to be. Terry Blas is an artist himself, but he's going to be writing that story. And you talk about different art styles. I'm looking ahead at some of the other books coming out after Pyroclast. One of them by David Bowles' child or David Bowles' son is Shaper, which just the art style is very different from the others. It looks more cartoony, but also has a lot of emotion to it. And then Vendaval is another one that has this kind of ethereal, kind of almost looks like a webtoon kind of art. And I'm really enjoying the different styles. So I'm also curious what it'll look like when everything comes together at the end and you get to see, you know, a variety of characters done under a new artist style, you know?
Yeah. So can I share?
So another question. So as they come out, the 1 through 13, do you then continue, like, for example, you know, Aldama, you put yours out and it's like, do you come back and collaborate later, or is it sort
maybe.
of again, like in the comic book world, when they
it's a maybe. These are one shots, and then we're gonna have the team up series by Terry Bluss. After that, we'll see where it goes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. We're gonna have our Chispa cinematic universe after all this,
right?
And it's gonna star Kevin Garcia on his way to the Cannes French Film Festival. So let me ask you both on the same related note. Can I share a little bit of my upcoming graphic novel vignette that I did with Oscar Garza?
Yeah,
called True Fences. It drops in January. It relates to everything we've just been talking about. So Through Fences, it drops in January. And this was, actually, we've got, you know, a nice blurb. Speaking of David Bowles, the omniscient, omnipresent David Bowles. But this is a braided graphic novel. Graphic novel in the sense that it's braided graphic vignettes, stories.
What do you mean by braided? I'm not familiar with that.
Braided, okay, yeah. Thanks, Kevin. Braided, it means that the stories exist in and of themselves.
Mm-hmm.
The story about Alberto, the story about each one has it, their own. Rocky has his own story. There's one, I mean, each one, La Maggie, Alicia, each one. And they're all youth, they're all young folks. But there's something in the story itself that braids it in with the other stories. So they're all US-Mexico borderland set. So, you know, Calexico, McAllen, San Isidro, you know. And the thing for me was on the note of author and artist working together. Now you'll see that this was with our local friendly Spider-Man, Oscar Garza,
mm-hmm.
who illustrated it. I picked Oscar because with Mashbone and Grifty and his work, it's very cartoony, very smart, very satirical. It wasn't so much the smart and satirical that I was aiming for, definitely the smart, but it was the cartoony because, going back to your point, Kevin, these are really hard stories. And if I had done the kind of photo, gone with the style of an artist who's more into the kind of realism of comics, you know, Batman Damned, whatever, it would have probably repelled the viewer. We needed someone like Oscar, who did the cover, by the way, to be able to.
What I love about Oscar, mm-hmm. with his work with Five Meats, is that he's able to take things that seem simple on the surface, but as you look at it, it has so much more depth to it. He did one for aimed at little kids, for example, the lemon pepper one, and it's just like every panel, while it, you know, might have a dot for an eye, you would still see there'd be emotion in the kids. There'd be, you know, something in the background that kind of tells you what's happening, what their world is like. And mm-hmm. I told him about this. I was like, man, you know, I you told me this was a book aimed at kids, and I didn't expect so much depth to it. And mm-hmm. and so I like the idea of having somebody cartoony like that to go for something that is emotionally powerful, like you're saying. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. So that just goes back to your point, Chukame, that you know, it is really important. And one of the things about working either for Chispa or working for ourselves or independent of kind of either the big comics publisher, Scholastic, you know, of course, the mainstreamers, DC, Marvel, but also, you know, Pantheon, et cetera, is that we get to choose our artists and they're not chosen for us.
Yeah. And yeah, having an artist match the story, always one of the vital things. It's not the first time you've worked in graphic novels before, right? You've done others before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, first of all, let me just say Latino Graphics itself, which is a trade press, mm-hmm. you know, that I curate and edit. I did, I established that, I founded that precisely because we need outlets. Yes. Chispa is doing a certain amount of work and it's very recent, but we need outlets. We need publishers, especially publishers that are not only going to get these into the hands of our readers, but into the hands of high schoolers, into classrooms, K through 12, fifth grade, et cetera. And a lot of that means having our books in, you know, the hands of librarians. And we need that huge apparatus that allows for and that opens doors into those spaces that the kind of mainstream, like Scholastic, seems to automatically have. And so, yeah, creating these spaces for, I mean, not just us.
Not to get too political, but if we do, fuck it. It's good.
It's a podcast. It happens.
Yeah, that's important because you're hearing so many stories about access to books these days it's good that there's somebody else. There's other people doing their own stuff out there, and you know, more power to them. And they're kind of curating their own material to try and supplant other material. I don't know. I'm not going to get into that part of it, but the fact that you're writing your own stories and making them available so that it reflects more of who other people are, in this case, myself, and people from our own, you know, background stories, families, because let's not shortcut ourselves from telling their stories, you know, so that's very
important. Yeah, no, we have to be there on the front lines, not only opening spaces, but defending librarians who, for the most part, are the ones most aggressed, teachers as well. But
librarians, by the way, Scholastic recently had their diversity button where you could choose not to have Latino or Black or LGBT creators. They put Chico, I don't know if you heard about that. They put on their website, they had a button you could put when you're ordering books, like, don't show me any books that might have diversity of characters or
you know. It's like the crazy part about how historically, at least in pop culture, librarians have had
librarians fought against it.
Yeah, librarians are either like this sexy woman, you know, the most boring person in the world, right?
But they're the ones on the front lines when it comes to books and free speech. Yeah,
right now they're literally in the front lines, and it's like, you should write a comic book about a librarian. It's like fighting people off and defending whatever.
And Scholastic, by the way, did walk that back. They said they're not going to do it anymore.
Well, only because of all the pressure, right?
Exactly.
It's like an equivalent of Indiana Jones, but instead of stealing stuff, you're putting stuff back. National Treasure or something like that. But
I was just at the local one of the local libraries up in Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, and fighting tooth and nail to keep the books. But it all started because a parent saw a special display that was kind of tied into a librarian who was given an invitation to the middle school to talk about LGBTQ coming of age stories. And one parent these days with social media and the megaphone creates hell for this one little tiny library that was doing the right thing.
Talk about changing times. Right before we started recording, Chikuma, you were asking about the economy, because that's since the pandemic, we've got issues of banning books, and we've got issues of people, going after free speech. But we've also had issues of, just funding things, right? What were you asking us about?
Well, I was just wondering, like, obviously everybody gets affected from, what you buy at the grocery store to, right, everything else, which is kind of important. And we do what we do here in the podcast, right, humbly. Try our best
for all the pay. We make the big bucks for that reason.
In some kind of Bitcoin, some kind of coin, ethereal or not. But yeah, like I imagine, like just supporting each other, because you know times are getting tough. So it was already tough, it seems like it, you know, and it's only gonna get tougher. So how do you see that landscape? Because it feels like hard times, right? You kind of make it through hard times, pop up through the other end, and hopefully, right? How do you see that landscape kind of evolving or devolving, you know, for whatever progress has been made as of yet?
Yeah. So, Professor, you know, as somebody who's published other people's work, is it trickier?
It is. It is trickier. But so now we're faced with the question, do I publish with and go with someone that's kind of mainstream, or do I go with someone who is maybe not going to get me into all the comic book stores or all of the libraries, but who will actually let me tell the story I want to tell?
Small published versus go after the big publishers where they're going to be giving you a lot of micromanagement. Yeah.
And basically, it's, you know, it's censoring, right? I mean, it's not the big visible censoring, like we're pulling your book from the bookshelf.
Or putting a button on a website.
Right. It's, you know what? You need to take this out because we won't publish it if you keep it in.
Yep. Yep. I've heard so many stories like that. So many stories. But what Chikuma said a second ago was supporting each other, right? And that's when I said a second ago that you've published other people. When I first met you virtually, you know, through an online interview, actually, now that I think about it, it was because you were promoting other Latino writers, other BIPOC creators. And one thing I've said 1,000 times that I love about the Latino comics community is that it's always about supporting each other. It's always about trying to promote not just our friends, but people who are just, you know, connect friends of friends, primos, you know?
Yeah, no, that's great. Yeah.
Why is that something you've put such a big effort on?
Yeah, because exactly what you just said. First of all, okay, so Chukume, like basically what? It's I'm in a position in my career where honestly, if I didn't write another word, I'd be more than fine. Like I've published so much and I'm at the kind of top, tippy top of the ladder, right?
So the AI would be the AI would know who you are.
So if I say AI. write in the style of Frederick Aldama.
Yeah.
The AI. Yeah, there's that. In fact, I just found out one of my books is the entire book has been swept into the AI brain. Anyway, that's a whole other story. But back to my point. Look, I think we're all there. Like the second that we get where we need to get, wherever that is, you turn around and you bring everybody with you.
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
And that's just the way it is. We don't even think about it.
At least leave some breadcrumbs or a string and hey, catch up, you know?
Yeah. I mean, so that's kind of my thing. And, you know, we got Latino graphics, you know, that, you know, has opened the door for a bunch, including, by the way, more stuff really focused on youth, Latinx youth, like the speculative fiction for Dreamers that came out, right? That Matthew Goodwin was kind of, you know, helming.
Yep, I met him through the online interviews too.
Mm-hmm. All of the other comics that have come through there, my original volume called Tales from La Vida, which by the way, you know, has become an anthology comic that has been adopted into classrooms across the country. It's in the Smithsonian Museum, you know, it's so like doing these kinds of things that have lasting deep impact, not just for the authors and creatives that we work with and that we love, but also for new generations coming up who can see themselves in these spaces. Brown Ink, I'm going to launch Brown Ink with Flower Song Press. It's the word and image book storytelling imprint of Flower Song Press. And I'm going to launch my book called The Absolutely Almost True Adventures of Max Rodriguez with that. So by so Brown Ink, Latino Graphics, Chispa, but then, you know, we've got other things coming right around the corner. Another edited anthology that I put together with Angela Dominguez, whom you've met. I think, Kevin, she's the one that's running the Latinx animation stuff out of LA. Yeah. She was a BIPOC. So we've got one called From Cocinas to Lucha Libre Ringsides. In a way, it's a sort of follow-up to the Tales from La Vida. And again, another way to kind of open doors for new gens of creators, storytellers, to kind of get their stuff out there. And we just keep doing it. You know, I wanted to show you both, and I know we're a podcast, but I did want to show you. This is, I'm going to drop the Steampunk Era Chronicles will drop
who's the artist of that?
So this is Miguel Hernandez. And
beautiful, beautiful work.
This is set in the mid 19th century in Mexico, but it's a steampunk, and the entire kind of super team are Latinas of very varied backgrounds, ancestral heritages. There's the little monkey Cogsworth.
Anyway, I appreciate that there's a monkey wearing a pilot's hat. That's you always need to have one of those. I love it. I love it.
So, you know, we are out there doing the work, man.
Which, I mean, it happened, like, a recent father, right? 2 and 4 year old. That's why I've been away, if anybody wants to know. and I'm here trying to raise my kids, educate them as best I can, to then pass them on to Kevin. So then Kevin can pass them on to Aldama over there. It's like the home, the school.
Pipeline, yeah.
Instead of the what is it?
Instead of the what is it? School to prison. We don't need that. We don't need that one.
Right. So, like, I now that the kids are of age, it's like they love going to these Comic Cons. Well, we would have Mexamericon coming up pretty soon.
Yeah. Right. In a couple weeks, November 4th, Mexamericon in Austin.
Is it still at the Mexican American?
Yes and no. It's still being hosted by the Mexican American Cultural Center, the MAC, but it's not going to be at there. It's going to be on the other side of the expressway. It's going to be east of the expressway.
Because last time they paired it up with what other event? I forget.
With the Day of the Dead celebration. Yeah, it still will be. That's still going to be kind of overlapping. So there's going to be a bunch of vendors there. One thing I loved about it last year is that we had a bunch of comic book artists and a bunch of like poster artists. And then we had a bunch of like vendors who make shirts and purses and all kinds of other kinds of like art pieces. Mm-hmm. And it was just, it was a cool combination of people. So you had fans of one type of craft and fans of one type of art coming and meeting the other type of artist. And mm-hmm. it was a beautiful crossover. It's going to be that again, yeah. But a different location. Professor, are you going to be there?
The Pan American Park, right? I'll be there 1 to 9 p.m. I'll be there. I'll be tabling.
Nice. I'll be there as well. I'll be hosting one or two panels there when we're there. Probably record them, put them online later.
Very cool.
You gonna bring the kids?
Yep. And that's what I was talking about. The kids now
better bring the kids.
Have access to that, you know, because I know some of you guys, and it's very easy for me to kind of it pops up in my feed somewhere. Oh, let's go do this. Let's go check this out. So that's just a lot more easier to kind of expose your kids to people. Mm-hmm. That they know they look like, you know, when they walk past the mirror on their way to school because they dressed up, and as kids become self-aware, trying to be as poetic as possible. So it's very easy. Like I got a wall in the living room full of like stuff I've picked up at Comic Cons, you know, and it's like class. I like what he does. And as that becomes much more available, that's pretty damn cool. Pretty damn awesome, you know, in my book. But what we were referencing earlier, that fight that keeps kind of, it feels like all of this was welcomed, because something would always pop up, or some reference would always pop up regarding that little black girl being asked what doll is beautiful, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, right? a lot of things like that, where it's like, when you don't get exposed to, you know, people not just like you but uh-huh. other people as a kid, then you just start seeing the default being, you know, white. So then, and this happened to me as well when I was a teenager reading X-Men comic books. One of the first thing I noticed was that whenever they had a character that wasn't, you know, plain white, they were always from another country. Now, I'm not saying it was great having immigrants in the story, but the idea was you couldn't be Mexican-American unless you were from Mexico. You couldn't be Brazilian-American unless you were from Brazil. And even a Storm, technically born in America, raised in Africa because, hey, she's black. We have to explain where she's from. And it wasn't until I saw the character of Skin join Generation X, who was a you know, U.S.-born, you know, Mexican-American, then I was like, oh, wow, somebody who has my background. You know, I was excited because it was just so rare to see in superhero comics. And then so we talk about that with a little girl as that example. If you don't see these examples, whether you notice it or not, it affects you, you know?
And they're here now.
Yes, we're kind of,
they're shining a light on it. We're, you know, more being created and, you know.
We're shining, we're making them shiny like Chispa.
And it just goes back to that. And it feels like, in my mind, it feels like there's some kind of, like, progress is not linear, right? One step back, what is it? Two steps back, one forward or something.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
So it's like, it feels like, okay, we have to, like, you can't get, sometimes you feel like, oh, that's so awesome. There's brown dolls at Walmart, you know? But then it's like, oh, what? Who's doing what to what librarian and Kansas are, like, is Texas the ground zero? Should I worry that much about it? You know, like, because my kids are, my four-year-old just started school at the, like, about a month ago, just started school. And it's like, God damn it, do I need to worry? I thought this was
resolved. Well, look, Florida's ground zero. Texas is at least ground two. We're okay. We're not okay at all. We're not okay at all. Yeah, but that's why we have to stay aware of it. We have to stay cognizant.
Yeah. Anyways, that's kind of like it's the battle is still there. The field is still in play, it feels like. And you guys are fighting for it. So thank you for that. You know, the best I can do is support. So that's one thing that, yeah, support. So.
Well, this podcast is really important, right? I mean, we need it to be coming in all. It's not just one. If it's coming at us from all directions in a way that's always been kind of like a straitjacket, well, then we got to be out there in all kinds of ways, right?
Because you have what's the former Huckabee, the former speaker or
the governor. Era.
So then it's like part of me wants to respect them because they actually believe that. But then part of me is like, no, they don't. It's just for show. And it's like, it's like you would at least imagine, let's compromise. No, they don't even want it. They just want to burn him. Like, what is it? What's that? Like, literally Fahrenheit 4. What is it?
451. Yeah, everybody always says, you know, fire, so. Book burners have always been on the same side of history. So,
yeah. So, yeah. It's like, and I don't want to burn anybody's books.
Well, you know what? This is why we have events like BIPOC Pop, right? Yeah. We talked about that at the beginning of our show. I want to come back to that real quick. BIPOC Pop is about supporting those voices, having communication between those voices, not just
inspiring those voices. Yeah,
exactly. And inspiring the next generation as well. Yeah. And I had said earlier that I like how the Latino comics community is very interconnected. BIPOC Pop expands that to people of other communities. Feather, could you tell us a little bit about like how that came about and what the goal is for BIPOC Pop?
Yeah, BIPOC Pop, you know, going back to Oliver point, which is you can try to hide from us now, but you're not going to get very far. Like, look, we are everywhere and we are doing amazing things everywhere. And Austin is like a hotspot for like, you know, our creators, thinkers, you know, right? Yeah. And you two being like at the kind of core, you know, and let's bring everybody together. Let's do this bigger than Latinx. Let's bring our brown, black, indigenous, Asian brothers and sisters together in and around comics, animation, video game arts, and celebrate one another, but also bring in new gens into that space so that they can carry the torch, the spark, the chispa, right? And continue to light those flames. And BIPOC, that's what it's all about. And, you know, we need Mexamericon, but we also need to clear and make, you know, forever and eternity, these places where we can speak to our brothers and sisters that share common histories, but also have very different experiences, to learn from one another, to grow with one another, and to lock arm and push hard against, you know, those people with the megaphones that are telling us to pull books from bookshelves.
Yeah, and not only that, it's like you can only reboot Iron Man so many times. Like, he's a badass character. What's it, Downey Jr. did a badass job with that. I don't think there'll ever be a better one, but you know, you can only reboot them so much before it just turns into the, and it feels like in today's entertainment cycle, things just move quicker, quicker, quicker. So it's not even like 20 years later, the remake of whatever. It's like, no, 5 years, 10 years later, and it's like, I'm still alive. Like, can you
wait? That's why we have to inject new blood into pop culture. New blood from new sources, new types of creativity, new types of creations.
You don't even have to fake it. Like, literally, the people are there. You just have to give people the opportunities for those.
What we're saying.
They have the power in their hand to do so. So, and you're not asking. And on the other hand, nobody's asking for a handout. It's like, it's good shit.
It's like we said earlier. It's we're promoting each other. Once somebody's been promoted, you know, they get fans or they don't get fans. They get readers or they don't get readers. But the point is, they probably would not have had that opportunity if somebody, like Professor said earlier, somebody with a megaphone didn't promote them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, before I forget, I wanted to mention November 11th, ooh, soft launch for the Latinx Pop magazine.
Ooh, I didn't know about this.
Yeah, and the Latinx Pop magazine is going to be, in a way, a kind of hub for people to go to. So, like, for instance, the Primos podcast is going to be there. Pop Cult X will be like resourced there. We'll also be generating kind of our own content, reviews, you know, thought pieces, you know, in and around new media, TV, film, and so on, in Latinx. But we want people to know that if there's a podcast or a website that has anything to do with Latinx pop culture and its peripheries, you could just go to the Latinx Pop magazine and find it.
So will you find my Primos podcast there?
Yeah.
You will find it, absolutely.
Okay, as a reminder, 13 Origins Pyroclast comes out November 22nd in comic book stores good comic book stores everywhere. You know, I already know Austin Books and Comics is going to have it. I know Tribe Comics here in Austin talking about it.
Okay, I'm going to say it again. Austin Books, because I've been just ordering
Austin Books and Comics. Yeah. We have so many comic book stores here in Austin, and I think all of them better be carrying Chispa Comics, the 13 Origins. Fede, thank you so much for coming. Missing Freddie in the cloud. But Fede, how can people find you online? Well, I already said earlier, they can just Google you.
Yeah. No. At Professor Latinx.
Yeah, exactly.
Professor Latinx, yep.
And Takume, out of curiosity, since you've been MIA so much, can people find you online? Is there a way to find you?
Leave me alone. Leave me the fuck alone. I'll be here when I fucking want to. All right. But hey, I wanted to ask the professor, last time I spoke to you, at least here in the podcast, you were about to move here, and how's it been? Because three of us are actually here in Austin, right? Like,
yeah. You know, it's been great. Great because of folks like you, Javi and everyone that puts on the Mexamericon, everybody who throws down for BIPOC Pop, the Latinx Pop Lab. You know, we've got incredible creatives like Kat Fajardo's in town, mm-hmm. Ashley Franklin's in town, all Latine, Latinx comic books makers, a ton of folks coming out of the Austin Bat Cave, Leticia, you know, everybody over there. So yeah, it's amazing. I mean, you moving from Columbus, Ohio to here, it's like, you know, I went from, you know, a great space once a year when we had SoulCon, which is something I put on, similar to BIPOC Pop, and the rest of the time it was a desert. And, you know, here we're around one another constantly. I get students from, you know, Kevin's high school. They call me regularly to interview me about, you know, what's your favorite adaptation and why, you know, things, crazy stuff like that. So yeah, I love that part. I have to say that there was a big sacrifice that I made. Mm-hmm. My daughter is, you know, I have been, put it this way, I have a lot of frequent traveler miles. She's in Columbus, Ohio. And she did get into LASA, by the way, Kevin's high school.
Good to hear.
But it was going to be, you'll be there, but it was going to rip her world apart to uproot her and bring her to Austin at
going
the time
cross country
that I got,
in high school. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's a particular time to up and go just like that.
Yeah. So for me personally, it's been, you know, a lot of traveling, but in the end, I made the right decision for lots of reasons, not just because of the awesomeness of Austin, but and the long-term big picture of everything mm-hmm. we're growing here in Austin in and around Latinx. But, you know, my kid's off to college next fall, and, you know, she's going to do just fine wherever she ends up. Keep your fingers crossed she gets in the UT Austin and she wants to come. That would be amazing. Then I would kind of have made up for time lost because she would be right here.
That's awesome.
That's beautiful. And I want to point out to other people who are visiting or thinking about visiting Austin, these events we've been talking about, BIPOC Pop and Mexamericon, they're free. You know, bring your families, check these things out, see the artists, talk to the writers. Thank you again so much, Feather, for joining us. You can, obviously, listeners, if you're hearing us, we are on all the podcast sources out there. My Primos Podcast. We're also myprimospodcast.com. Check us out. And on all the social medias at My Primos Podcast. And, I just realized, without Freddie here, no one's been calling me at KevinGarcia_com. He calls me every time. But, man, it's been a lot of fun. Thank you all. Thank you, Primos, out there. Good night.
Enjoy the weather. It's finally not that hot anymore. Hey, bye.